Hello everyone and welcome to the After Hours Gaming League. This is game 3 of Bluehost versus Google Word Search. Oh, and what an exciting series it has been. I am so ready to see what happens here in this final matchup between these two teams. If you haven't seen games 1 and 2, I would very much recommend you look at game 1 and game 2. Both sides had some very strong picks from both teams, and I think that's going to have a huge implication on this pick fan phase. In fact, we already see it being reflected here again. Very quickly, let me introduce the teams here. On the blue side, we have Google Word Search, and on the red side, we have Bluehost. Ironically, on the red side twice in this series. For the updates on who those companies are and what charities they're playing for, tune into Game 1. But I'm not going to repeat myself multiple times on this because my voice is already starting to get hoarse and I don't think I'm going to make it to the rest of the match. So, we'll just go right into the pick bans here. Udyr being banned out this game. Of course, Vine, Thresh, Cassiopeia, all already standard bans as we've mentioned before, targeted at each other. But the changes here over this series have been the Udyr ban now coming in for Google Word Search. Absolutely do not want to allow that Udyr to get back through, because that was an insane no answer for the whole game for that Udyr. So an absolute must ban. I'm glad to see that change. For the red side, they are banning out Nasus. Cannot allow that Nasus to get over to the blue side yet again. But they're actually opting to opt out to ban out Orianna this time, which has been somebody who's been a just standard pickup for both sides. Hasn't really seen too many like insane Orianna plays throughout the series, so I'm interested in why there's an Orianna ban specifically when that Jinx was still available. Remember, in game 1, it wasn't just that Nasus, it was that Jinx. Jinx went insane. So we're going to see again for the third match in a row, it's going to be a Jinx Graves bottom lane. And the red side, you know, losing that first matchup, I actually believe every game Jinx has been on the blue side. So that's an interesting dichotomy for everybody who thinks that, you know, Graves' early game is more important than Jinx's late game. So just throwing that out there as a point of information for you guys to pontificate on. But regardless here, we're seeing them stick to their guns on this red side, saying, no. We lost the Graves Jinx matchup initially in the first go around. Not gonna happen this time. We're locking in Graves. We see your Jinx. We can beat it. We know how to do this. So let's see what comes out here. It looks like they're gonna go for something a little different here with that Morgana coming in as a possible support, possible mid lane, but probably a support. Oh, and could this be the trick up of red side sleeve? Could it be the Blitzcrank coming out? With that Morgana already locked in, it does make it less likely. But there it is! The Blitzcrank gonna be coming out. It's gonna be absolutely critical test of how well Morgana can throw out those black shields as soon as Blitzcrank begins that pull animation. If she can do that, this Blitzcrank Graves lanes is gonna have no effect. This is going to be absolutely nullified, but can she do it? Will she be able to get that done? That's going to be the question for this bottom lane. So, in these previous matches, it seems like that bottom lane, as goes bot lane, goes the game. So we're gonna keep a close eye on bottom lane to see what happens there. But I do want to point out, the Udyr ban this time around left the Mundo open. There's Dr. Mundo being picked up by this red side, banned out in the other games, not banned out this time, and there it is, snagged up. I'm excited to see that Mundo come out, and with, again, with that Maokai, with that, there it is. I'm so pleased to see this actually happening. We'll get into that in a second here. With that Maokai, with that Morgana, that is a lot of magic damage that's going to be coming out, with, of course, the Trinity Force on Hecarim. That is a lot of magic damage coming out. Mundo loves magic damage heavy teams because then he gets to rush that Spirit Visage, get that huge boost to his ultimate self-healing ability. So that's going to be fantastic for Mundo. He's loving seeing this team composition. And, you know, as we mentioned before in the previous game, that we're going to see in the mid lane, not in the top lane, but in the mid lane, is going to be this Hecarim. I'm very interested to see how this plays out. We've mentioned briefly, I mean, it's been banned, so we talked very briefly about that Hecarim being banned. Traditionally, nowadays, being seen in the top lane, seen running that Smite Ghost, or Teleport Smite. This is even going to be more different. I mean, when Hecarim in recent memory originally burst onto the scene, right before he became a more standard thing in the top lane, we saw him briefly in the mid lane. So to see this Hecarim mid and not running Ghost, not running Smite, this is going to be something very different than we're used to seeing. This is going to be a very different kind of Hecarim. So it's all up in the air as to how this Hecarim is going to build. Is it going to be a more damage move speed Hecarim? Is it going to be a Hecarim that's about the same sort of Trinity Force into a tank normal standard transition? We're clearly going to see home guards. That's why teleport's being picked up. You got to have those home guards. But what does the ignite mean? Is that ignite something that's going to actually be something saying, hey, I think I can kill a Cho'gath in lane? I'm not necessarily sure that's what it means. I think it means this is going to be a more damage-oriented Hecarim who's going to want to build damage items, who's going to want to get that Yomu's Ghostblade. Like, we're talking ultra-rapid-fire mode-style Hecarim here. Speedy Pony who's going to come for blood. That's the kind of Hecarim I think we're going to see here. That Hecarim that goes to Trinity Force, Yomu's Ghostblade, and then considers transitioning into perhaps the Spirit Visage to get the extra healing on. The Randuin's to slow people, to keep them in his range. But I could be wrong. I don't know what we're going to see. We're going to have to wait, watch how the game goes, keep our eyes peeled for it. But we're going to have ourselves a fun mid-game. This is a game 3 to behold right here. As of course, we're also need to comment as well on that Cho'gath. A fairly non-standard pick nowadays. Coming back into flavor, but always very strong. If you can get those 6 stacks, actually be able to maintain those 6 stacks and devote your ultimate just to chunking people out on cooldown, you don't even have to get kills with it. You can just shove them right out of lane. As soon as you hit like level 9, level 10, feast people on cooldown, get that damage out there, or save it more conservatively for a burst. If that Hecarim, again, my feeling is this is going to be the Hecarim who wants to fight. So if that Hecarim goes in, is a little low, bites off a little bit more than he can chew, Cho'gath's going to bite off exactly what he can chew, and what he can chew is going to be a pony. So we'll see how this all shakes out. But again, with that very delicious and tasty mid lane, we can't lose sight of, again, what has been the deciding factor in this matchup for these two previous games, which is the bot lane, which has been a Jinx versus Graves every time. The supports have fluxed, though, and this is by far going to be the most decisive support choices yet. It's going to be that Morgana. It's going to be that Blitzcrank. Putting aside later on whether or not Blitzcrank is going to pull the right people into the team, whether or not he's going to be able to find Morgana or Jinx, whether or not Hecarim's going to be even a person who's squishy enough to want to pull, who knows? But in the laning phase, this Blitzcrank is going to be absolutely terrifying every time that cooldown is not up. The recent changes to Blitzcrank's move speed is that he gets a little bit higher move speed, but after it ends, he actually gets a little self-slow. So, I'm not sure how practice on the new, the current patch Blitzcrank this is. If you're pulling this out in Game 3, I'm assuming you've ran some practice matches with these changes and gotten used to that. But if you can't capitalize on that initial movement speed to get somebody out of position, catch somebody out of position, punish somebody who is out of position, then you are almost instantly going to become out of position. So we'll see what happens with this Blitzcrank, who actually is not in the game. That was my mistake, as we see here. This is clearly a second Mundo on the team for the red side here. But we're going to see, it looks like, possible invade coming out from the blue side here. They're going to just send some people forward to scout out what's happening here, to keep an eye out for that Blitzcrank. Make sure nothing funny happens here. Morgana going to want to level either that Q or the pool first, depending on how hard they want to shove that lane if they want to play a little bit more defensively. And, you know, again, I am surprised to see no interest in doing a lane swap here. With that Maokai, he's going to be able to Twisted Advance away if he's pulled by the Blitzcrank. So to see this Maokai just hanging out, cheating a little bit towards the top side of the map, hinting that he's going to go up topside and try and go up against Mundo, who, again, you know, likes to build that MR initially. So if you sent the duo lane up against that Mundo, that would kind of cut him off at the knees, make it so he's not able to rush into that MR. He might have to consider building a little bit of armor first. But instead, Mundo, it looks like, is going to get that 1v1 matchup he wants. So I got to question the blue side's choice here of whether or not they should actually stick into this. Because again, whether or not they're confident on the Jinx, Jinx is a late game oriented champion. Graves is not. Graves is ready to fight you at level 2 and do as much damage as humanly possible. So I appreciate and respect the confidence to still take this on and sort of let this be the final deciding moment here. But I do really question whether or not it's the right thing to do strategically when you had knowledge of where this team was. So they very easily could have initiated a lane swap. And it looks like Hecarim bullying this Cho'Gath very heavily. That Q just barely missing on the Graves. Early level 2, oddly enough, going to Morgana. Perhaps she cheated some of the experience away from Rek'Sai there. Off of the Krugs, or just got delayed a little bit quicker. No, it's definitely Krugs. It's not just a minion here or there. But Cho'Gath, there's that sustain from Cho'Gath's passive coming into play here. I am a little surprised to see no boot start if this is going to be a more aggressive Hecarim who wants to trade this hard. I would expect to see a boot start instead of just a flash start here. Certainly a flash start is very good, as you're going to tear through that mana as Hecarim. You're going to need that sustain. But if you're going for frequent trades, I would think it might have been better just to go boots and pick up a mana pot or two. But we'll see how that lane shakes out here. Clearly it's working out all right now, as we see Hecarim bullying that Cho'Gath around, taking a lot of minion damage though, getting a little overconfident there. As we've yet to see any pulls landed by the Blitzcrank, of course, the camera will snap down there as soon as a pull is landed, so the fact that we haven't been watching the bot lane too much means those pulls haven't been finding their targets or haven't even been thrown out yet. Beautiful QW! Trying to bait out the pull onto herself, ready and waiting with that black shield as Morgana. Perhaps Blitzcrank is just sort of being a little studious here. Hold that thought, actually, because here comes the knockup. Cho'Gath does land the knockup, and that's first blood onto Cho'Gath in this mid lane. And oh no, this is not going to be the best example of the mid lane pony. Well, going a little into the face of the minion there. Just a little bit. Yeah, not too much of a CS advantage coming out for the Cho'Gath here, opting to just immediately back to make sure they get back at the same time there. But it does have an item advantage, going to get the mana crystal as well as the health crystal. So not a huge advantage. Going to wait for the black shield to expire. There's a flash, actually pulls the Morgana, seeing that she had flashed, knowing black shield is down. And that will be the kill coming out, but here is Pony teleported successfully into the lane. The burn from the ignite gonna be enough. And the damage from Sejuani is gonna be enough as well. Gonna jump over that wall. Will the Pony be able to catch him? Pony doesn't have boots available. Pony gonna have to be dissatisfied with that, as that was a 2-for-1 in favor of this red side here. Already a 1k gold lead, and things are not shaping up well for the blue side in this game. Level advantage is in favor of Cho'Gath here, so some good bursts from the Rek'Sai coming up, but needs to be a little bit careful about some extended trades here with the Cho'Gath. Always makes you real confident when you can dodge those Qs, but then all of a sudden, Qs aren't the only things you have to dodge if you're getting close. And you lose your mechanism to dodge too if you get in too close. Anyways, we're gonna chasing that Blitzcrank out a little bit. Not gonna go too far out, but ready with the black shield should something like that happen. Gonna throw out the Q, force him. Actually does land the Q as well. Getting a little bit of that Spell Thief's proc. Always admire that. I'm not quite able to jump out of that in time, but he's gonna go for a little bit of trade here as the Rek'Sai is coming in. The flash knockup comes out. There's the beautiful Q from Cho'Gath forcing the disengage. Now that is the Cho'Gath Qs I like to see, right on top of yourself, saying, hey, if you want to get in auto attack range as a melee, you're not gonna do it. You might as well just back off now. Disincentivize any further trading. Okay, looking to try and trade, speaking of trading, right as Mundo is hitting 6 here, but unfortunately couldn't get too much done. And now Mundo, with that 6 available, is definitely going to be able to sustain through any damage that can come up. And it might already be too late in terms of finding some kills in this top lane. But we see a battle here of the two junglers right outside Dragon Pit. Blitzcrank going to be the first to rotate around. Gonna force Rek'Sai back. Fairly even trade between the two, though. Rek'Sai still looking to start off this dragon, or to get the scuttle crab to get vision prepared for dragon, but hold that thought. Rek'Sai so low, not gonna be able to go down though. Jinx thinking about the ultimate that she doesn't have available. Wishing for that ultimate. Seeing that blinking red Sejuani, I know how much that wish is out there. Actually, there's the teleport from the Pony. No, not even the teleport. Just seeing that ward. Hold on, let's go back. Watch that again. Watch where this... Watch the Pony's journey. We gotta watch this. Sees that the Scuttle Crab is taken. Thinks about going back. Thinks better of it. Wants to try and find a pick here. Can't find it. They're pinging out. They know he's there. They actually see him going up towards us. Perhaps thought he was going back to mid lane, but... Still not seeing him come out. The ward should have given it away. Just window shopping here was Sejuani. Didn't notice Hecarim going up on the long way. Didn't notice the ward being placed out. And ends up losing her life for it. Unfortunately, those items a little too attractive at times. Forcing the window shopping, not able to get too much out of it. Ends up giving up a kill here to the blue side. That was wow, I think I heard the point at which I lost my voice there. Blitzcrank just barely missing that hook. Beautiful chain CC though. Actually, reverse order than usual. Usually Chompers into the binding, but actually going to be the other way around this time. He's looking to get some harassment down there, but needs to be wary of that pull. Now comes a slow. Oh, just barely over Jinx's shoulder that time. Very close from the Blitzcrank there, just not able to make it. Very close. But Rek'Sai now in that bottom lane. Perhaps could be waiting out, see if they can find something here. Gonna interrupt that back again. Jinx does have ultimate available if Blitzcrank gets too low. I mean, he does have that passive shield with the tier though, not any raw mana built up. Pony just gonna try and run away here. Rek'Sai not enough to disincentivize the chase. Pony goes down. Somehow Mundo not getting any assist credit. Rito, please. But that will be the kill going over to the blue, to the red side here. Now this dragon will be going down. First dragon of the game. The ultimate from Jinx not going to be able to get it. We'll just leash it up so that Cho'Gath can feast it on down. Get another stack ready. Graves really wanted to take that trade there. Even opting Jash right in as Morgana was coming out. Has the confidence here. Doesn't have the level advantage. Doesn't have an item advantage. So perhaps getting a little cocky here. Without that Blitzcrank in tow. Feigning that there's a Blitzcrank hanging in around in one of these bushes perhaps. Blitzcrank just now showing himself back in the lane here. Pardon my moments of silence. I'm just trying not to burn my voice completely out here. We see the jungle items now completed for both the junglers here. Of course, the challenging smite coming out for the Sejuani, or for the Rek'Sai here. With that, I do believe that's the AD. It's so hard to tell from a distance. But yes, that is the warrior enchantment. And the, of course, juggernaut enchantment here for the Sejuani with the Cinder Hulk. But going for that Chilling Smite, actually opting for something a little bit different here, will hurt her clear time of the jungle camps a little bit. Trying to bait out the pull, and perhaps would have even let herself get pulled to get the Soul Shackles going with that Rek'Sai in tow there. Fortunately, Blitzcrank thinking better of it, not throwing it out, just hanging out here instead. Letting that tier pass up, or stack up, I should say, bit by bit. And that Blitzcrank going for that tier is going to mean that Blitzcrank is in a huge power drop. Because that tier, I mean, it's just regen. It doesn't really help that shield. Slowly, as it does stack, it helps that shield more and more. But it's going to be a painful ride up there. You see Sejuani scouting out that blue buff area. Not able to find anything for her trouble, but we'll get the reset on that so they will know when it does spawn again here. So we look at the difference in vision right now. Not very much vision on the top side for this blue team, but they do have some good wards, some defensive pink wards and some forward wards to spot out for them. As we see some trades going back and forth here in this mid lane. And for the red side, only that deep ward in the blue buff area and a ward in the tri bush on top side. Not too much vision, actually very lax in vision here. I'm interested to see if that Sejuani is going to opt to turn that ruby crystal into a second sight stone. Now that Blitzcrank does have a sight stone of his own completed here, they might just decide that's enough. Gonna throw down the black shield preemptively, thinking she was about to be all in, but we'll get some nice return poke. Not gonna mean too much on a tanky Sejuani, but always feels good. And here comes the Rek'Sai, looking to try and make something happen, but just gonna tunnel and force that Cho'Gath away as the pull does come out, but unfortunately goes wide there. Now we'll be Maokai. Coming in, taking that turret, ignoring Hugo. But all that thought, because here's the Morgana, who was silenced by that ultimate from Blitzcrank. Gosh, my throat hurts. I'm so sorry about choppiness here. And that ultimate from Sejuani, she will be interrupted. She's going to flash under the turret for it, though. And there's no mana available on this Morgana. But that will still be her going down in the end. Looks to try and get a sneaky turn, but isn't able to do so. Graves left alone with the turret a little bit. Not sure if they'll be able to get anything for her, but hold that thought, because Mundo, popping the ultimate, has got the chase, has kept the Maokai in range. Maokai trying to go, he does find a way to flash over that wall. Mundo, I believe, failed flash trying to get that wall. Let's keep our eyes peeled up here. I do see that summer go on cooldown. And yeah, that's a very unfortunate. That was a tricky flash to land there. Max range, very practiced Maokai there, flashing over that wall. And Mundo just jumping the gun by just a few pixels. Very unfortunate, not able to continue the chase. Could have gotten a kill there onto Maokai for sure. Was he able to chase him all the way through? Pony taking a lot of minion damage here. Needs to be careful. Make sure he doesn't get within feast range of that Cho'Gath, who, you know, is sitting with that feast available. Yeah, that is a 6 stacks Cho'Gath already, so he's Rek'Sai. Thinking about going in, but Tanky Cho'Gath, certainly not the one you want. Gonna have to just take that red buff instead. Dragon coming up in 40 seconds now. So we see Blitzcrank running ward duty with Sejuani here. As Cho'Gath does now have that Rod of Ages built and stacking here. Well, yeah, is gonna have that take out, but no. The slow coming in, just too much for Blitzcrank to pursue that hard. Gotta throw out the Desperation Hail Mary on the pole. Unfortunately for him, it does not find its mark. Cho'Gath able to one-shot those caster minions now with a Q, now that he's got that Rod of Ages stacking here. And it looks like that's going to be the dragon. A little out of position here is the blue team. Going to start this up, try and rush it down. Blue side is aware that this is going on, and Rek'Sai might try and be a hero. She might tunnel in for the steal. Does she go for it? No, she does not. As Cho'Gath will secure it with the feast. More damage than a smite can offer at this point in the game. At all points in the game, really. Unless if something goes terribly wrong. Cho'Gath, using that feast to secure it, does not have the damage there, and actually flashes over into still Jinx's auto range. And the last tick of Ignite goes down, getting the kill for the pony. And that is a 2-for-nothing going over to the blue side. Definitely what they wanted to see here. After losing that second dragon of the game unanswered, the red side got a little cocky, extended just a little bit too far, but hold that thought because we might have a little overextension. No! Twisted advance into the pole to save his team. Maokai, MVP there, blocking off, perhaps even unintentionally, but blocking off that pole on a squishy. Gonna result in another kill. So an extended 3-for-nothing. And just like that, this blue side has rocketed into the lead. Now, 1.5k gold lead ahead of this red team. And with that, we're going to see the items start to dip in favor now of the red side. Jinx got those tier 2 boots to nothing on Graves. The Trinity Force completed with the boots. Not quite up to tier 2 yet, but close there, and certainly that home guard going to be rushed as soon as possible afterwards on this hacker room, is going to be looking to back as soon as possible to get that available for his teleports. So a very close item break coming up for this hacker room as well. And in the top lane, Maokai, I do believe, is fully stacked at this point. No, halfway stacked. He got that a little bit later than I recall. So yeah, Maokai hitting his stride there with that. And Rod of Ages getting stacked as well. Beautiful step forward there. Not going to worry too much about a single auto attack from Cho'Gath. And Jinx, the Turret Destroyer, does finish that up. And that will be the gold lead extended a little bit further, as now the blue side taking the turret lead. Oh no, but the pink ward baits out the pony, and he does go down. Pulled in, knocked up by the Blitzcrank punch, followed up again with another knockup by the Cho'Gath Q, chain CC'd so long he couldn't even ultimate to get out of there. And that is the potential of this red side team. If they can get that CC chain on a pick target like that, they're done for. They're absolutely done for. And if they can get that Sejuani involved in that as well, then that's going to give so much time for Mundo to just AoE people down. For Graves to auto and just wail away on people. Land those abilities onto the squishies if possible. Cho'Gath so far ahead here. Hold that thought, because we're seeing a skirmish break out here. That's four members for the blue side here. That's a beautiful knockup, and that's gonna be a kill on Cho'Gath, losing those stacks. Very critical kill there. Sejuani gonna be able to jump over the wall, no trouble, but will be followed by the Maokai, who flashes, and then the twisting advance gonna be enough to finish him off. And here's Rek'Sai following as well, tunneling over, and there's an ultimate from Jinx. Not gonna do anything though. Blitzcrank gonna survive with that passive, which is now on cooldown. But that, most importantly, will free up a push opportunity in this mid lane here, as this turret gets wailed on by the turret destroyer Jinx here. Beautiful Q, and there's the pony gonna ultimate in off of the Q. Fantastic play by Morgana to land that at max range to set it up for the fear, for the absolute destruction there. And now all of a sudden that's four turrets down, a gold lead that is now 4k large. I mean, that's insane. This game is getting out of control right now. And again, we gotta talk about how Jinx is a late game oriented champion here. Now that she's hitting her stride, now that she's got that IE completed, now that she's got the Zeal building up there, getting ready to complete that into what looks like probably a static Shiv coming up, Jinx might be far enough ahead to make this, or far enough into the game with the gold resources she's had available, to make something happen here. And Pony now, with that home guard teleport ready, with that Trinity Force complete, is looking like he's opting to go a bit more of the standard route here. Beautiful black shield, absolutely denied it. That pink ward being a hero, soaking up some damage for the Blitzcrank as Jinx aggroed onto that one first. Again, looking at the CS disparities here, Rek'Sai almost double the CS of Sejuani. I feel like this engagement is not about to help too much, as this red side is caught out 3v5. There goes down Graves already, the primary damage dealer gone. Sejuani, the primary tank, gone. Cho'Gath forced to flash away defensively. And yeah, you get Scuttlecrab, but at what price? Unfortunately, red side might be starting to get a little fatigued here in the third game with everything on the line. This is the ticket into the top 16, the next week of championship playoffs here for AHGL, or a ticket home. So this pressure might be building a little bit on this red side, as now this is going to be another inner turret going down. Cho'Gath doing what he can to try and fend them off, and simply unable to. With five members here, wave clear just isn't available for this red side team. And again, that's one of the problems you have when you pick a Mundo. The wave clear is absolutely atrocious on Mundo. Unless if he's so far ahead, he can just walk into places and not really worry about taking any damage. Because there's that beautiful, gorgeous pony. running out of that base with that home guard looks so great. Yeah, again, looking at the scores here, we see the Rod of Ages fully stacked now for both the Rod users here. The Iron Strides have been hit, but Cho'Gath now up to five stacks. He's already stacking it back up, only one cooldown away from being back to max tankiness here, being able to provide that role for his team. See that blue buff being taken down by this Maokai. Gobbling that on up as Hecarim certainly doesn't really need the blue buff too much. Wouldn't hurt to have it on Hecarim, but Maokai can actually use that mana sustain a little bit more than Hecarim can, so definitely good to spread the love around there. As we see that Randuin's, or excuse me, that Spirit Visage almost completed for this hack room. Just not quite there yet, but that will help his sustain in these extended fights a lot as soon as he does. Help that self-healing. Increase that and stepping a little far forward will Blitz pull him. Gonna wait. Gonna be very patient here. They're gonna catch him out. We're gonna keep our eyes peeled on this bot lane here. Pony's so fast, but how fast does Pony have to be? Blitzcrank lands the pull, lands the knockup. Here's Cho. Q, not yet available. Hecarim forced to ultimate over the wall. They do see him. They know it's warded. Or Hecarim knows it's warded. Gonna opt to just farm a little bit. Do some dirty farming. He's here. Might as well. And the thinking is it's gonna buy enough time for the rest of his team members. And he's absolutely correct as the minions shove in the mid lane, fully distract them, make sure they have to go up to this top lane where this fight is going down. Beautiful Zonius from there in this turret. Oh, surviving so long. That's gotta be Morgana going down to that last Q, and there she does. And Mundo goes down as well. So much action going over him, and now here's the Pony joining the fight. There's the Praise Seeker in the last swing of the whatever kind of scythe thing that the Pony uses. I'm not sure what you'd call it with that skin. But regardless, taking a lot of turret damage from that inner turret during that fight means they're probably not going to be able to secure this inhibitor turret. But overall, that was a favorable trade. 1-2 in favor of the blue side here. We're actually seeing a Ludens Echo pickup on this Cho'Gath, looking to do a lot of magic damage here. Definitely needs it. His team needs to diversify their damage for sure. But I mean, you've got a Moon, or you've got, excuse me, a Maokai. You've got a Hecarim. They're already building MR regardless. You don't really need to worry too much about forcing them into that. I really question that pickup here. Cho'Gath doesn't seem like the most natural fit for a Ludens Echo. I would expect more to see a Liandry's Torment, a Rylai's Crystal Scepter. Perhaps provide a little bit more CC for the rest of his team here with that slow on whoever he can land those abilities onto. Get a little bit of extra penetration with the Liandry's. But just to go in a raw AP Ludens Echo, I do really question that decision. So Rek'Sai going to be picking up that 30 gold. Skullcrab will be going over to the red side here as this dragon is going to spawn in under a minute. Actually, unless Pony can contest it. Pony doesn't have smite this game though, but he's going to chase them away. Pony 7-3-3, too scary right now. Graves, oh, does manage to secure it with the buckshot. That's definitely going to be helpful here. I mean, that speed shrine, more important than the vision, is denying that speed from Hecarim, who's going to really want to use that speed shrine for a fight at the Dragon Pit if that's what happens. Maokai is split pushing this top lane, though, so while they're waiting for this dragon to spawn, Maokai alone escorting some minions, but hold that thought because Pony is pulled, forced to ultimate away, and just like that, that could mean the dragon is uncontestable here. Pony gonna be forced to go back, but is gonna be looking to just give this up and teleport back in. Into that top lane, perhaps. No, he's gonna hang around in this bottom lane, does cancel that recall. If we can actually switch back to the view here on the dragon, there we go. People getting zoned, people dancing around that dragon pit. Nothing too fancy going on in that top lane here. And they are going to decide just to give it up once they've been thoroughly outpositioned here. And now all of a sudden Mundo realizes, oh, the team's here. And Mundo, very tanky though, he's got to turn off that ability if he wants to not die. He actually makes it out, even with the ability running the whole time. Incredible, the regen on that Mundo is just so much. And that is going to be two kills unanswered yet. No, there's the first kill for Jinx, getting a little excited here. does not have the ultimate available, already used it. Those two blinking red members are going to make it out alive. But with them recalling, will they be able to shove these minions out, try and get this turret down? They do have a Jinx, but here they come back. Mundo looking to give her the business here. Not going to be able to find her. Just barely out of range. And with that slow, with the chompers down, going to be able to fend him off, protect that very low Jinx. If one of those cleavers would have landed, that definitely would have been a dead Jinx. So lucky play there that she was able to get out alive. Lucky play by the Mundo initially, too, to be able to leave that, I believe, W running the whole time and not tick down. He came so close during that team fight while he was regenning up to actually burning out there. Perhaps there was an ignite on him. I'm not sure. I do not recall if he was ignited by that Hecarim. And the pull just barely going wide. Oh no. Should have thrown down that ward right before the pull. A very important mistake there, because that black shield had expired. But unfortunately, that's not going to result in a kill onto that Morgana. That could have spelt a Baron there. Could be a very key misplay that results in a lot of ramifications here. Always going to be hard to tell those what-ifs, but now we'll never really have an opportunity to know here. They will spot out this pink ward. Actually, going to defend that turret. Morgana taken so low. Build no magic resistance so far. Does have that Zonya's completed. If she's going to go for that more, get in the middle of a team fight, I would expect to see more of an Abyssal Scepter follow-up there. Looks like she's favoring the cooldown a bit here instead. But that does mean she's going to be very vulnerable to this Cho'Gath, who is essentially going rod, glass, cannon, Cho'Gath here. I mean, picking up another needlessly large rod. Oddly enough, he does opt for the magic resistance boots here, the Merc Treads. So not entirely accidentally aggroing the Baron there. That is Rek'Sai with that AoE effect. The AoE of coming out from under the Baron. Hold that thought here. Speaking of the damage, look at that. Even with the black shield, immediately burned through the black shield. Gonna have to be the smite that finishers are off. But wow, that damage from Cho'Gath. So strong here. I'm very surprised to see him, if he's going for this build, get something like a Merc Treads, when there's not a lot of significant magic damage coming out from this blue side. The only real significant source is that Morgana, who is, in the end, still just a support. Certainly nice to have some MR, but sacrificing what could be a lot of penetration from some sorcerer shoes. I'm not sure how much I agree with that decision, if this is the build Cho'Gath was going to opt to go for. Looking for a fight here. Possibly getting a fight they weren't looking for here. Down goes Rek'Sai, and all of a sudden, a 3v5. The only smite is down. Mundo way out of there. It's a 4v4. Now it's not. Mundo gonna be teleporting in way too late. Oh no, what could have been a 4v5 situation. Absolutely turned down by Mundo, who teleports in far too late. Despite getting the first kill onto Rek'Sai, that is the only kill in that fight that goes over to this red side. Could have just simply backed away after that as well. Used that smite advantage to pick a better fight once Mundo had arrived at the Baron Pit. But they do not do so. And that's gonna mean that this is the turret going down. Mundo, no threat. Mundo cannot poke these people away. And that is an inhibitor going down for free after that 4-for-1 exchange. And all of a sudden, what looked like it was about to be a comeback moment for the red side just took it a little bit too far, got a little bit too excited off of it, and doing their best impression of Jinx, I suppose, getting very excited off of a single kill, but then ran a little bit too quick, got ahead of themselves. Now the dragon is spawning here in 30 seconds or so. So they're going to want to throw down some vision around there, perhaps try and go for that fourth dragon. And again, I mean, this is four dragons. The game is certainly by no means over at this point. Don't let that nearly 10k gold lead fool you. When you're at three dragons to one and another dragon's about to spawn, when you're all in position around that dragon with that Cho'Gath, I mean, the Smite and the Feast, that's going to be your dragon. And if you can get to four dragons, you can get to five. And if you can get to five dragons, you can win. So, definitely don't count them out yet. Rek'Sai is in the vicinity. That Scuttlecrab is going to go down in favor of the blue side, though. I do believe that was in favor of blue side, at least. Yes, it was. So, Pony's going to be extremely strong in this fight if they try and fight it out. They might have to try and delay this as long as possible. Wait to see if they can get a pick or just try and stall out. But, I mean, the blue side's stepping very far forward here, forcing them back, saying, hey, you either fight us right now or you surrender this dragon. And that's exactly what they're going to do, as this dragon will be going down. Second dragon of the game for the blue side here. But most critically, again, denying that fourth dragon. Blitzcrank getting a knock-up there, but the Pony's not necessarily the one you want. Morgana throwing down a Q. There's a beautiful Acro Ultimate onto five people. They're all so low right now. It seems to be just a matter of time. There's the Cho'Gath going down. That Graves, poor Graves, going to dash over the wall. Not going to be able to get anywhere with it, though. There's the Smite coming out. And Graves going down as well, says Ronnie. Somehow able to recall in the blue side's jungle, but that's going to be because all five members have grouped up. All five members are going to get those kills, and then all five members are going to go back to Baron. The Super Minion still streaming into the base. Absolutely no way to contest this here. Sejuani and Mundo thinking about it. Sejuani and Mundo need to think better at this point. Akram running interference, just wasting their time at this point. And there it is. That's the Baron going down to this blue side. Blitzcrank just now able to get in the area. Realize it's too late. Realize there's nothing he can do. He's just a machine. He is no man. He is but merely a machine. And he cannot contest the dragon as a machine alone. Perhaps if he was one of the brilliant machines by Heimerdinger, he could contest it, but we don't consider that lore in-game. We only consider the actual cause of a spawn here, and he is merely created by a Nexus in this map. So unfortunately, not able to contest that Baron. That will be the Baroned up team. With an 11k gold lead right now. Pony gonna be grabbed, but I mean, that's a Pony. I don't know how much you want to grab him. He's gonna be able to do quite a bit of damage here. And Cho'Gath just eating it from the Baron of Minions. Oh my goodness. So much damage. I mean, it looks like one of the previous games where there was Banner of Commanded up as Super Minions there with the Baron buff. But there weren't even, there was just three cannon minions with Baron buff. Absolutely chewed through the tanky Cho'Gath. Who, to be fair, isn't nearly as tanky as normal, given that he is going for a bit more glass cannon of a build. And that is going to the Jinx Rocket, hitting multiple people. Rek'Sai does go down, though, getting a little bit too aggressive, but getting a little too aggressive in kind is the Graves, stepping a little bit too far forward, though essentially there's nothing you can do. So many minions in the base, the Baron buff still up. Super Minions still streaming in through the middle lane. And I mean, this is just a matter of time here. Juggling the aggro of the champions between them only can last so long here. Sejuani gonna go down to the last tick of Ignite there. Mundo trying to give Jinx the business, but not able to do so. Cho'Gath coming in trying to be a hero with that Feast, but wasn't able to get in range of Jinx. Mundo simply flashing, and there's the ace. That's going to be the game going over to Google Ward Search on the blue side here. Blue side, 100% victory in this series, 100% OP. And, I mean, it's very impressive to see that this Jinx play in both of these games from Google Ward Search, able to go into a Graves lane and come out as the primary carry for the team. doing so much damage. Morgana landing lots of Qs in those team fights, getting that Zonya's completed fairly quickly, was able to lock down a lot of people, throw her body recklessly into the team fight, and then just stasis and be fine. But perhaps the hidden carry of the game, the never killed 2-0 and 18 Maokai, building that locket for his team, negating a lot of the magic damage that was coming out, and building so much tankiness, fully stacked Rod of Ages, full tank items, was always up in the front of the team, and was so tanky he never died once. That Maokai, I mean, obviously the highlights that are going to be talked about for this game are going to be that Hecarim in the mid lane showing up strong 10, 4, and 9. There's going to be that Jinx again into an unfavorable, supposedly laning phase, showing up huge 11, 2, and 11. But we gotta give some props to this Maokai in the top lane, coming out with no deaths, always being the engage from his team. I can't remember a team fight that he wasn't involved in. I mean, apparently there was 7 kills, but I don't know how many team fights Maokai wasn't involved in, wasn't throwing himself into the middle of things and causing great peel for his team, soaking up tons of damage for his team. And a strong showing on the Sejuani for the red side, but unfortunately that's just not going to be enough in the end. Maokai looking very quickly here at just damage taken. Where is Maokai here? Yeah. Not actually taking up just about as much damage as Rek'Sai and Hecarim here, but killed infinitely less times. So, I mean, it certainly does help when you've got a Rek'Sai who wants to go in with you and you've got a Hecarim who wants to go in with you. But this maybe is a team composition that people need to think about going into the round of 16 matches. Whoever gets matched up with Google Ward Search, maybe they need to think about giving a little bit more credence to that pony. Maybe they need to think about making sure that Jinx doesn't end up in their hands, because, I mean, it seems at least that whenever that Jinx gets chosen by this blue side, or by this Google Ward Search team, they show up big on her. So if that's not going to be a ban, you got to first pick it away, because they've demonstrated some clear proficiency on that. So, I mean, congratulations to both teams for making it to the round of 32 playoffs, but that will be in the third and final game, Google Ward Search taking the win, going on to the round of 16 next week. And that is it for me today. Thank you all for watching. I hope you enjoyed this tournament series here. I will see you guys next week for some more matches in the round of 16. And for everybody watching the live stream, thank you so much. We have, of course, we'll be live streaming it to this channel as well. All the uploads next week for the matches iCast will be uploaded to this channel as well. And you can always stay tuned to the lovely website displayed on your screen here, afterhoursgaming.tv. All the schedules will be posted there. All the matches will be posted there. All the casts will be posted there. And if you feel so inclined, feel free to stay tuned to this channel, subscribe, whatever, watch some of these previous matches. And I will be uploading, again, all the matches following Sunday as well. So hopefully I will see you guys then, and enjoy the rest of your weekend.